Late in the night of Valentine's Day 2014, air monitors at an underground nuclear waste repository outside Carlsbad, New Mexico, detected the release of radioactive elements, including americium and plutonium, into the environment. Ventilation fans automatically switched on to exhaust contaminated air up through a shaft, through filters, and out to the environment above ground. When filters were checked the following morning, technicians found that they contained transuranic materials, highly radioactive particles that are not naturally found on Earth. In other words, a container of nuclear waste in the repository had been breached. The site was shut down and employees sent home, but it would be more than a year before the bizarre cause of the incident was released. I'm Grady, and this is Practical Engineering. The dangers of the development of nuclear weapons aren't limited to mushroom clouds and doomsday scenarios. The process of creating the exotic transuranic materials necessary to build thermonuclear weapons creates a lot of waste, which itself is uniquely hazardous. Clothes, tools, and materials used in the process may stay dangerously radioactive for thousands of years. So a huge part of working with nuclear material is planning how to manage waste. I try not to make predictions about the future, but I think it's safe to say that the world will probably be a bit different in 10,000 years. More likely, it will be unimaginably different. So ethical disposal of nuclear waste means not only protecting ourselves, but also protecting whoever is here long after we're ancient memories or even forgotten altogether. It's an engineering challenge pretty much unlike any other, and it demands some creative solutions. The Waste Isolation Pilot Plant, or WIP, was built in the 1980s in the desert outside Carlsbad, New Mexico, a site selected for a very specific reason – salt. One of the most critical jobs for long-term permanent storage is to keep radioactive waste from entering groundwater and dispersing into the environment. So WIP was built inside an enormous and geologically stable formation of salt, roughly 2,000 feet or 600 meters below the surface. The presence of ancient salt is an indication that groundwater doesn't reach this area since the water would dissolve it. And the salt has another beneficial behavior. It's mobile. Over time, the walls and ceilings of mined-out salt tend to act in a plastic manner, slowly creeping inwards to fill the void. This is ideal in the long term because it will ultimately entomb the waste at WIP in a permanent manner. It does make things more complicated in the meantime, though, since they have to constantly work to keep the underground open during operation. This process, called ground control, involves techniques like drilling and installing roof bolts in epoxy to hold up the ceilings. I have an older video on that process if you want to learn more after this. The challenge in this case is that eventually we want the roof bolts to fail, allowing a gentle collapse of salt to fill the void because it does an important job. The salt, and just being deep underground in general, acts to shield the environment from radiation. In fact, a deep salt mine is such a well-shielded area that there's an experimental laboratory located in WIP, on the other side of the underground from the waste panels where various universities do cutting-edge physics experiments precisely because of the low radiation levels. The thousands of feet of material above the lab shield it from cosmic and solar radiation, and the salt has much lower levels of inherent radioactivity than other kinds of rock. Imagine that, a low radiation lab inside a nuclear waste dump. Four shafts extend from the surface into the underground repository for moving people, waste, and air into and out of the facility. Room and pillar mining is used to excavate horizontal drifts or panels where waste is stored. Investigators were eventually able to re-enter the repository and search for the cause of the breach. They found the source in Panel 7, Room 7, the area of active disposal at the time. Pressure and heat had burst a drum, starting a fire, damaging nearby containers, and ultimately releasing radioactive materials into the air. On activation of the radiation alarm, the underground ventilation system automatically switched to filtration mode, sending air through massive HEPA filters. Interestingly, although they're a pretty common consumer good now, high-efficiency particulate air, or HEPA filters, actually got their start during the Manhattan Project, specifically to filter radionuclides from the air. The ventilation system at WIP performed well, although there was some leakage past the filters, allowing a small percentage of radioactive material to bypass the filters and release directly into the atmosphere at the surface. 21 workers tested positive for low-level exposure to radioactive contamination, but thankfully were unharmed. Both WIP and independent testing organizations confirmed that detected levels were very low. The particles did not spread far and were extremely unlikely to result in radiation-related health effects to workers or the public. Thankfully, the safety features at the facility worked, but it would take investigators much longer to understand what went wrong in the first place, and that involved tracing the waste barrel back to its source. It all started at the Los Alamos National Laboratory, one of the labs created as part of the 1940s Manhattan Project that first developed atomic bombs in the desert of New Mexico. The 1970s brought a renewed interest in cleaning up various Department of Energy sites. Los Alamos was tasked with recovering plutonium from residue materials left over from previous wartime and research efforts. That process involved using nitric acid to separate plutonium from uranium. Once plutonium is extracted, you're left with nitrate solutions that get neutralized or evaporated, creating a solid waste stream that contains residual radioactive isotopes. In 1985, a volume of this waste was placed into a lead-lined 55-gallon drum along with an absorbent to soak up any moisture and put into temporary storage at Los Alamos, where it sat for years. But in the summer of 2011, the Las Conchas wildfire threatened the Los Alamos facility, coming within just a few miles of the storage area. This actual fire lit a metaphorical fire under various officials, and wheels were set into motion to get the transuranic waste safely into a long-term storage facility. In other words, ship it down the road to WIP. Transporting transuranic waste on the road from one facility to another is quite an ordeal, even when they're only going through the New Mexican desert. There are rules preventing the transportation of ignitable, corrosive, or reactive waste, and special casks are required to minimize the risk of radiological releases in the unlikely event of a crash. WIP also has rules about how waste can be packaged in order to be placed for long-term disposal, called the Waste Acceptance Criteria, which included limits on free liquids. Los Alamos concluded that barrel didn't meet the requirements and needed to be repackaged before shipping to WIP. But there were concerns about which absorbent to use. Los Alamos used various absorbent materials within waste barrels over the years to minimize the amount of moisture and free liquid inside. Anytime you're mixing nuclear waste with another material, you have to be sure there won't be any unexpected reactions. The procedure for repackaging nitrate salts required that a superabsorbent polymer be used, similar to the beads I've used in some of my demos. But concerns about reactivity led to meetings and investigations about whether it was the right material for the job. Ultimately, Los Alamos and their contractors concluded that the materials were incompatible and decided to make a switch. In May 2012, Los Alamos published a white paper titled "Amount of Zeolite Required to Meet the Constraints Established by the EMRTC Report RF 10-13, Application of LANL Evaporator Nitrate Salts." In other words, how much kitty litter should be added to radioactive waste? The answer was about 1.2 to 1, inorganic zeolite clay to nitrate salt waste by volume. That guidance was then translated into the actual procedures the technicians would use to repackage the waste in glove boxes at Los Alamos. But something got lost in translation. As far as investigators could determine, here's what happened. In a meeting in May 2012, the manager responsible for glove box operations took personal notes about this switch in materials. Those notes were sent in an email and eventually incorporated into the written procedures. Ensure an organic absorbent is added to the waste material at a minimum of 1.5 absorbent to 1 part waste ratio. Did you hear that? The white paper's requirement to use an inorganic absorbent became an organic absorbent in the procedures. We'll never know where the confusion came from, but it could have been as simple as mishearing the word in the meeting. Nonetheless, that's what the procedure became. contractors at Los Alamos procured a large quantity of Sweet Scoop, an organic wheat-based cat litter, and started using it to repackage the nitrate salt wastes. Our barrel, first packaged in 1985, was repackaged in December 2013 with the new kitty litter. It was tested and certified in January 2014, shipped to WIP later that month, and placed underground, and then it blew up. The unthinkable had happened. The wrong kind of kitty litter had caused a nuclear disaster. While the nitrates are relatively unreactive with inorganic, mineral-based zeolite kitty litter that should have been used, the organic, carbon-based wheat material could undergo oxidation reactions with nitrate wastes. I think it's also interesting to note here that the issue is a reaction that was totally unrelated to the presence of transuranic waste. It was a chemical reaction, not a nuclear reaction, that caused the problem. Ultimately, the direct cause of the incident was determined to be an exothermic reaction of incompatible materials in LANL waste drum 68660 that led to thermal runaway, which resulted in overpressurization of the drum, breach of the drum, and release of a portion of the drum's contents, combustible gases, waste, and wheat-based absorbent into the WIP underground. Of course, the root cause is deeper than that and has to do with systemic issues at Los Alamos and how they handled the repackaging of the material. The investigation report identified 12 contributing causes that, while individually did not cause the incident, increased the likelihood or severity of it. These are written in a way that is pretty difficult for a non-DOE expert to parse. Take a stab at digesting contributing cause number 5. Failure of Los Alamos Field Office, NA-LA, and the National Transuranic TRU Program / Carlsbad Field Office, CBFO, to ensure that the CCP, that is the Central Characterization Program, and LANS, that is the contractor, Los Alamos National Security, complied with Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, RCRA requirements in the WIP Hazardous Waste Facility Permit, HWFP, and the LANL HWFP, as well as the WIP Waste Acceptance Criteria, WAC. Still, as bad as it all seems, it really could have been a lot worse. In a sense, WIP performed precisely how you'd want it to in such an event, and it's a really good thing the barrel was in the underground when it burst. Had the same happened at Los Alamos or on the way to WIP, things could have been much worse. Thankfully, none of the other barrels packaged in the same way experienced a thermal runaway, and they were later collected and sealed in larger containers. Regardless, the consequences of the catastrophe were severe and very expensive. The cleanup involved shutting down the WIP facility for several years and entirely replacing the ventilation system. WIP itself didn't formally reopen until January of 2017, nearly 3 full years after the incident, with the cleanup costing around $500 million. Today, WIP remains controversial, not least because of shifting timelines and public communication. Early estimates once projected closure by 2024. Now that date is sometime between 2050 and 2085, and events like this only add fuel to the fire. Setting aside broader debates on nuclear weapons themselves, the waste these weapons generate are dangerous now, and they will remain dangerous for generations. WIP has even explored ideas on how to mark the site post-closure, making sure that future generations clearly understand the enduring danger. Radioactive hazards persist long after languages and societies may have changed beyond recognition, making it essential but challenging to communicate clearly about risks. Sometimes it's easy to forget, amidst all the technical complexity and bureaucratic red tape that surrounds anything nuclear, that it's just people doing the work. It's almost unbelievable that we entrust ourselves, squishy, sometimes hapless bags of water, meat, and bones, to navigate protocols of such profound complexity needed to safely take advantage of radioactive materials. I don't tell this story because I think we should be paralyzed by the idea of using nuclear materials. There are enormous benefits to be had in many areas of science, engineering, and medicine. But there are enormous costs as well, many of which we might not be aware of if we don't make it a habit to read obscure government investigation reports. This event is a reminder that the extent of our vigilance has to match the permanence of the hazards we create. I talk a lot about news stories related to engineering, and I get a lot of emails from journalists wanting to interview me for stories they're working on. About a year ago, one of those requests landed in my personal email. Not a big deal, but I try to keep that inbox separate, so I asked how they got the address, thinking I had accidentally posted it somewhere. The answer was, I think, kind of brazen. They said, "We just bought your information from a data broker." I knew that was a thing, but it was surprising to see it admitted so openly. At the time, Incogni had recently reached out to sponsor a video. I told him, "Let me give it a shot, and then I'll decide." We all get junk mail, spam emails, and telemarketing calls. You kind of think that stuff is unavoidable, but those lists have to come from somewhere. And robocalls are annoying, but data brokers can have more insidious effects, making it easier to steal your identity, take out loans in your name, stalk you, and more. Plus, algorithms can use personal info to decide what ads to show you, and even the prices you pay for products. Many of these services offer a way to remove your information, but there are hundreds of these sites, all with their own specific form to fill out. That's where Incogni comes in. You authorize them to act on your behalf for this one specific purpose of removing your information from online databases, and then you're done. You can log on to see all the websites that have taken your info down, and Incogni just keeps working on it behind the scenes. I've been using it for an entire year now, and they estimate that if I were to do all this myself, it would have taken me 300 hours. It's tough to correlate this directly to a reduction in spam, but it definitely seems like I've gotten fewer unwanted phone calls since I signed up, and all the interview requests use my work email address now. But what's more important to me is the proactive part of it. It just helps make it harder for individuals and companies to use my and my family's personal information in unwanted ways. And if you like the same peace of mind, they're offering 60% off an annual plan at the link in the description. Take back control of your personal information at incogni.com/practicalengineering. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.